Geeks, welcome to another video. So today we will be discussing about the past year's questions from CSIR NET that are based on the biochemistry unit. So if you are someone who needs to revise your 12th knowledge, who needs to prepare for biochemistry numericals, you are at the right place. In this particular section of series, we are going to do all the questions that are asked from the past year's papers, which entirely depend upon the knowledge you had gained in 12th standard and some general concepts. So for this unit, that is unit 1 of CSIR NET, I have made a video on all the important topics. I'll link it up in the I button so you can go there and check out all the topics you need to cover to be done with this unit. Now, majorly from this biochemistry unit, the types of questions that are asked are based on the basic chemistry that you did in the 12th standard. Topics majorly come from thermodynamics that include the Gibbs free energy, entropy, enthalpy, and you have delta G. So delta G, delta U, enthalpy, temperature dependence, and so on and so forth. So thermodynamics deals with this, even the first law of thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics. These type of questions we are going to solve in today's video and in another video, the continuation part. The other thing that we are going to solve in this part is from the pH related questions. So how to find pH of solutions, when two solutions are mixed, the resultant pH, pH of the buffers, the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Then there are many questions that are asked from kinetics to calculate the rate of reaction. So rate of the first order reaction, second order reaction, the units of the rate constants. The next type of questions that are asked are from the basic topics of absorption. So basically how to calculate the absorbance of different solutions by using the Beer-Lambert's law. So there are many questions that come from this section as well. Then questions on the melting temperature and GC content. So these are the different important questions that are asked from this particular section. So I have made videos on each of this. I will link it in the description down below. The link for the playlist will be in the I button. Make sure to look at all these videos to understand an idea of the past year's questions and prepare accordingly. So now, without much further ado, let's get right into this video. So firstly, to solve any of the questions, you need to understand about Gibbs free energy. The Gibbs free energy is denoted by the letter G. And by definition, what is Gibbs free energy? It is also said to be the available energy. And if I have to give a simple definition, the definition says that it is the amount of useful energy. Okay, so it is the amount of useful energy that is present in a thermodynamic system that can be utilized for doing work. So it can be utilized to perform work. So it is that energy that is stored in a system which can be utilized to do work. Another definition is it is the maximum amount of work that can be done by a closed system. Okay, so this is the second definition. There is another definition that says it is the quantity used to measure. So it's the quantity that is used to measure maximum amount of work done in a thermodynamic system at temperature and pressure constant. So at a constant temperature and pressure, the quantity that is used to measure maximum amount of work. So everywhere you can see that it is closely related to work and it is the amount of energy that is available. So remember, this is G. Now, how to calculate this G? So basically, depending upon what is your given value, there are different formulas. So the most three basic formulas that we are going to utilize is, the first one says delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Now, what are these? So delta G is obviously the Gibbs free energy. What is delta H? It is the enthalpy. Okay, enthalpy. Now, delta H can be positive or can be negative. If the reaction is an endothermic reaction, then delta H is positive. If it is an exothermic reaction, delta H is negative. For a revision, I'll just tell you, endothermic reactions are those that absorb energy. So if energy is absorbed, then the positive sign for delta H. If in the exothermic reaction, it is the release of energy. And therefore, the delta H is a negative value. Next, T. T is nothing but the temperature, which is measured in Kelvin. Very important to convert degree Celsius to Kelvin. Okay, so if your question gives the temperature in degree Celsius, you can convert it to Kelvin by adding 273. Then delta S is the entropy. Now, what is entropy? It is the randomness of a system. And remember one thing, entropy is positive when the randomness increases. Positive when the randomness increases. Now, when does the randomness increase? Basically, when you go from a ordered state, okay, ordered state to a completely disordered state. Meaning, now we have our solids. Solids are perfectly ordered. They have a very defined structure, a regular repeating structure. So it is highly ordered. When you go from solid to liquid to gas, these are all more and more disordered. So solid particles are very regularly arranged, but gases, the particles are just randomly moving around. So this is an highly disordered state. So the sign convention for entropy is positive when the randomness increases and negative when the randomness decreases. So if you come from G to liquid state to solid state, then the entropy is a negative value. So these are the terminologies and the first formula. Let me give you the second formula. So I will just rub off some of this area so that, you know, I can write over here. Now, after understanding the first formula and the terms involved, let us try and understand what are the other formulas that can be applied. Okay, so just fit it in your mind that G is Gibbs free energy, H is the enthalpy, and it has two values, positive and negative. Positive when the reaction is, yes, endothermic, when energy is absorbed. Negative when energy is released. Delta S, it is entropy, and entropy, the value can be positive again and negative. Positive when we go from a highly ordered state to a disordered state. Okay, now there is other thing that you need to understand is how to get entropy. So the formula for finding entropy is that delta S, which is entropy, is equal to Q upon T. Okay, so this is the formula that you have to remember. Q is the heat of the system, and T is the temperature, heat or energy, you can say. Okay, now let us move on to the second formula involving delta G. The second formula is delta G is equal to minus RT ln K. Now, to convert natural log to the log to the base 10, you multiply by the factor 2.303. So this is 2.303 RT log to the base 10 K. Okay. So this is one particular formula that you will need to apply a lot. Now, what is R? R is the real gas constant. Okay. And the value for R that you will apply depends on the unit. So if the value for G, Gibbs free energy, is in calorie, then you have to apply the calorific value of R, which is nothing but 1.987. So you have to remember this value. If the value of G is in, so if it G is in calorie, then you apply this value. If G is in joules, then the value for R should be also in joule per Kelvin per mole. So the value is 8.314. So remember these two, and accordingly, depending upon what the G value is, you have to choose the value for R. What is K? K here is the equilibrium constant. What is K? K is the equilibrium constant. And how do you get the equilibrium constant? So basically, it is a simple formula to calculate the equilibrium constant. It is the concentration of the product divided by concentration of the reactant. This is how you find the equilibrium constant. Okay, so this is the second formula that you need to apply. Now, there is another formula, that is the formula number 3. And the formula number 3 can be written in this manner. So the formula number 3 says that delta G is equal to delta G naught plus RT ln K. Now, what is this? Both the equation shows two delta G. One is delta G and the other one is delta G naught. Now, what is the difference? Whenever you find this delta G naught, it indicates standard enthalpy, standard free energy. Okay, what is standard? The condition is that the reaction should occur at STP, standard temperature pressure. What is standard temperature? 25 degrees Celsius. What is standard pressure? 1 atmosphere. So at that particular condition, the value measured is delta G naught. And delta G is other than standard. If the reaction, standard conditions, if the reaction takes place, you have this value. Okay, so if at all in a question they give you the standard free energy, then this is the formula you will apply. So here are the three formulas that you will require to solve questions on this. Now, like we discussed, for H and for S, that there are different values at different conditions. Similarly, for Gibbs free energy, you have different values. And what those different values tell you? Delta G is a very good indicator of spontaneity of a reaction. Whether a reaction is spontaneous or not can be understood by the delta G. Okay. So if the delta G value, that is the change in the Gibbs free energy, is zero, that means the reaction is at equilibrium. So neither is it going in the forward direction nor in the backward. The reaction is at equilibrium. If the value for delta G is positive, that is if delta G is greater than zero, then the reaction is non-spontaneous. What does non-spontaneous mean? That it would not take place on its own. An external force should be applied to do the reaction. And the third case is when delta G is negative or delta G is less than zero. In that case, the reaction is spontaneous. And most of our reactions in the system are spontaneous. They do not require any external energy. So these are some things you need to remember to solve this type of questions. I would request you to pause the video down and write this information so that you don't have to refer to any other book and you can get all the questions very, very easily. So let us move to the first question now. So what does the question say? For an endothermic reaction to occur spontaneously, which of the conditions should be satisfied? And we just discussed, right? For spontaneity, what do we look at? At the delta G. And when is a reaction spontaneous? When the delta G is negative. So in this case, the delta G is negative, and therefore the reaction is going to be spontaneous. So delta G, when it will be negative? When delta G is less than zero. That is my option C. Less than zero means the value would be negative, right? So these kind of simple questions are asked in CSIR. It didn't take any amount of thinking. You could quickly get 2 marks. Now, next question. So this says, if in glycolysis, if concentration of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, so they have given you glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and the concentration is 2 × 10⁻⁶. And DHAP, this is nothing but dihydroxyacetone phosphate, and that is concentration 4 × 10⁻⁴ at a pH of 7.2. They have given you the standard free energy value for this particular reaction. Now they are asking you, what will the reaction proceed? So they are asking you which side will be the reaction more favorable to. So this must definitely ring a bell. This we have seen in, yes, glycolysis. So in glycolysis, we know that DHAP is isomerized to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is further used in the pathway, right? Now, what is the main thing we are going to see? See, the reactions, the options say more towards glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, more towards DHAP. At equilibrium, cannot be predicted. So instantly you can remove this option, remains at equilibrium. Because equilibrium, delta G would be equal to zero. That's not the case here. It cannot be predicted. This is also incorrect because delta G value should be enough to tell you the direction of the reaction. So first option says more towards glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Now, look at this. You will see that the delta G value is a positive value. Positive means that the reaction is non-spontaneous. So that means that this reaction doesn't happen. Glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate doesn't get converted. But the reverse reaction is definitely going to be spontaneous. Because when you reverse a reaction, you reverse the sign of this particular value as well. So for the reverse reaction, the delta G will be negative, and delta G negative means reaction would be spontaneous. And therefore, the reaction where the DHAP is converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is more preferred. So more towards glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is the correct answer. And move to the next question. Now here, they have given you the value for delta G naught as 1.36 kilocalories. Okay, the binding constant they are asking. So binding constant means what? It's a constant, and the only constant we know in these equations was K. So definitely this is something that they have asked you to find. So what is the formula? Just look at your pages. So it is delta G naught is equal to minus RT ln K. So to convert it into log, it is minus 2.303 RT log to the base 10 K. So here K is supposed to be found. So keep K at one side, and this will become minus delta G naught upon 2.303 RT. Okay, so now log K will be equal to minus 1.36 kilocalorie. Converted into calorie, so raised into 10⁻³. 2.303, the value for R, the value for R that you are supposed to take is 1.987 into, this is given as 25 degrees Celsius. We need it in Kelvin, so add 273. So this becomes 298 Kelvin, right? So add 298 Kelvin. Pause the video and solve it. Let me know what do you get. So when you solve the numerator, this is what you will get. And the denominator, my multiplication, this is what we receive. Now finally, when you cancel this out, you're left with minus 10⁻³, right? Now, when you solve it further, when you find log K is nothing but anti-log of this number, and this comes out to be 0.1. Which is nothing but my option B. Great. So I think it was super easy to solve this. Another question of the similar type. Here again, they have given you delta G naught value as 18 minus 18 kilojoules. What else is given? Temperature is given. Now they are asking you equilibrium constant. Can't be more direct. Again, the same formula, delta G equal to minus 2.303 RT log to the base 10 K. Therefore, log to the base 10 K will not be nothing but delta G upon 2.303 RT. So this is minus of minus. So that becomes plus 18 divided by 2.303. Now this is again in kilojoules. So converted into joules, multiply by 10 raised to 3. Why we did it? Because R, the value for R is 8.314 joule per Kelvin per mole. So therefore you need to convert, and here you will use the joule value because delta G is in joule and temperature is 300 Kelvin. So quickly pause the video and continue solving this. And once you're done, you can unpause. And yes, if you do the solving part, the value comes out to be 3. Now, log K is equal to 3. So what is K? K comes out to be 1361. Now, obviously, this is not the exact value that is given here, but you get the idea. It's option C, the closest value. Okay. So many a times we just use to save your time, they just use round figures. So if you just use round figures, you will come roughly around this value. Okay. So very simple, very easy to do. Now let us read through this reaction. Now, most of the students, what they do is they look at the question and it seems so big with so many reactions. And they instantly, try to see another question. But just understand, the bigger the question, the easier it is to solve. I'll tell you why. Now look at this question carefully. So the question says all of these things. What I can make out is the value for delta G naught is given over here. Okay. And this value for delta G naught is for which reaction? For glutamate and ammonia to glutamine. So basically the reaction of what? Glutamate. So glutamate plus ammonia gives me glutamine, and this value is plus 14 kilojoules, okay, per mole. And now this is coupled to an ATP reaction. They have given you the reaction ATP plus water giving ADP and phosphate. And this reaction has a delta G value of minus 30 kilojoules, okay. Now, they are asking you what is the delta G value for this reaction. That is glutamate plus NH3 plus ATP gives glutamine plus ADP plus phosphate. Now, just looking at it, you can make out that here you have glutamate, ammonia and ATP. So basically, isn't it that these two reactions have been added to get this reaction? Definitely, that's the case. So all you need to do is add this reaction with the other one and you will end up getting this. So 14 minus 30 comes out to be how much? Yes, it's minus 16. And therefore, the answer to this reaction is minus 16. As simple as that. Okay, let us go to the next one. The next one says the standard free energy change for this particular reaction A to B at 30 degrees Celsius. So again, 30 degrees Celsius temperature is 1000 calorie per mole. So you have the delta G naught value. What is the approximate free energy change that they are asking you? Basically, delta G. When the concentration of A and B are 100 millimolar and 100 micromolar and 100 millimolar. Now see, delta G naught, I forgot to tell you that the concentration in the standard state is taken as 1 molar. So this A and B were 1 molar and that time you had a delta G naught value of this. But when the concentration has been changed, the delta G will also change. So therefore, you are very well aware when you have delta G naught and delta G, what is the possible reaction you can utilize? Yes, this formula delta G is equal to delta G naught plus RT ln K. Now, I want it in log, so I'll just write this as minus, I'll just write it as, not minus, I'll write it as 2.303 RT log to the base 10 K, just that difference. Now, I have the value for delta G naught, that is 1000, correct? 1000 calories plus 2.303 R. R is real gas constant, now this is in calorie. So the value you will put is 1.987 into temperature, which is 30 plus 273. And how much is that? 303 Kelvin, correct? Into, now you have to find K. So what is the reaction basically? The reaction is A gives B, right? So I told you what is the value for the equilibrium constant. It is the concentration of product upon concentration of reactant. So here also in this case, it will be the concentration of the product, that is B. Now, what is the concentration of B? They have given you concentration of B is 100 millimolar. Now, milli to molar will be multiply it by milli to molar. So milli is a smaller unit, from this millimolar, you're going to molar. And then form the value for this is 100 micromolar. So micro is 10 raised to 6, milli is 10 raised to 3. Am I correct? Yes? Okay. So that is the value. Now, here, how am I going to get this value? So basically, how much is 2 plus, so this is milli, therefore I did 3, okay? And this is micro, so I did 6. Now this is 6, 7, 8. So this is nothing but 10 raised to 8. And the above one is 10 raised to 5. Now minus, so this is 10 raised to 5. When this comes up, it becomes minus 8. That comes out to be 10 raised to minus 3. So the equilibrium constant is 10 raised to minus 3. And if you multiply all of this 2.303 into 1.987 into 303, and the log of this comes out to be minus 3. So this is minus 3. So if you multiply all of this, it comes out to be 100. And the multiplication is 4159. And the minus sign that comes with this log will cause you to minus these two. And if you minus the two, it comes out to be 3159. Okay, so the value for this is 3159, which is our option A, right? So it was that easy to do. If you knew just one formula, you can easily cover these topics. Okay, so now for the next type of sum, you'll have to watch the next video of mine.